Well, everybody, they've done it. EA Sports just dropped the 6-minute Dynasty Deep Dive video for College Football 25, and can I say, the excitement could not be higher. We have a few more weeks until the game officially launches on the 16th in early access, but man, are they building what is probably the best sports game to release ever. I feel like it's safe to say ever. Everything they showed in this Dynasty preview video, not only in that, but also in this 1700 word, 85 page Dynasty campus huddle looks incredible. Madden reskin where exactly? But let's start going through this Dynasty deep dive. A lot of stuff to go through. I'm gonna try to fit all this into one video. Links for both the video and the Dynasty deep dive article will be in the description if you wanna read or watch it for yourself. But I'll do my best to cover the important things. Obviously, if you're not familiar with the game mode itself, Dynasty is your coach control play out seasons game mode, similar to franchise mode in Madden. You have the ability to obviously take over a team as head coach. You can also start off as an offensive or defensive coordinator, or even leave a head coaching job and go down to an offensive or defensive coordinator. Your ability to pretty much do whatever you want from a staff perspective is on the board. That is ultimately the journey that takes place in Dynasty mode, and that is one of the three pillars of this mode. So build your coach, also build your program. And building your program, building a successful program, is done through recruiting not only high school players, but also transfer portal players, and maintaining your roster. Because while you recruit and bring in players, you also need to keep in mind that there are going to be players that want to leave your program depending on opportunities, playing time, how your team is performing. And then they talk about delivering the world of college football and how a lot has changed over the past 11 years since NCAA 14. The new 12-team college football playoff format, we have conference realignment. Ultimately, they are giving us the tools to create our own college football experience. So, for example, me personally, in my dynasties, the Pac-12 will be coming back. That is an option. That was actually really cool to see in the Dynasty Deep Dive video that you have the option to bring the Pac-12 back, and all those teams that left will be returning. So get ready for that. Obviously, before you start building your program, you have to build your coach. And they've added a very interesting progression system for coaches this year, not just head coaches, but also for coordinators. So whichever way that you personally decide that you want to play College Football 25, that decision ultimately is up to you. It's not about being perfect. And that's one thing they noted in this section of the article, is that a lot of coaches in college football are one of three things. They're either really good at recruiting, they're great recruiters, they're great at motivating their teams, or they are very good tacticians. You have some coaches that are a mix of two. You have some coaches that aren't good at any, but there are very few teams that have coaches that are great at all three things. It's about building a staff or being part of a staff where you, as a head coach, for example, have coordinators that complement your skills and also soften your weaknesses. It's a constant rock, paper, scissors relationship, as they say in the article. Coach progression is pretty straightforward. If you've played Madden recently, if you've played NCAA 14, a lot of these concepts will be familiar to you. There are four categories of coach XP goals that are achieved through either single game, weekly, seasonal, or career challenges. Once you earn enough XP, you upgrade your coach level. When you upgrade your coach level, you get coach points. Those are used towards abilities. There are 50 max levels to achieve. They list off a couple of examples here. Some of these are pretty obvious, like beating a rival, beating a top 25 team, winning a national championship, having the top recruiting class, ranking top 10 in offensive yards, and then having players drafted in certain rounds will earn you different types of XP. College Football 25 is adding a very interesting RPG-like archetype system to the game with 11 different archetypes that have their own focuses and perks. The archetype you start with is based on the backstory you choose for your coach, so motivator, recruiter, tactician. You have different hybrids based on how you decide to build your coach by allocating coach points. And because there are so many different options, but only 50 coach levels that you can achieve, there's, again, no one way to be great at everything. You've got to choose what you want to focus on and allocate those points where you think they best fit your team, your coach, and ultimately your program. Upgrading or unlocking a new coach archetype is not just based on the amount of points you pour into it. There's also certain challenges that need to be met. So for example, the elite recruiter, you need 50 coach points put into that recruiting archetype, and then you also have to sign 2 top 5 recruiting classes. So this isn't something that you can just speed run and acquire in 1 year. This is gonna take multiple years of effort in order to achieve some of these archetypes, which I find fantastic. I actually love that. Certain archetypes also give you certain opportunities on the coaching carousel, and they also give you a perk when active. So another example here, the tactician archetype has a winner perk, which awards additional coach XP every time you win a game. Pretty simple. The active archetype for your coach is based on the amount of points you have allocated, so it's always changing. But if you own certain archetypes like program builder or CEO, those will always be active regardless of how many coach points you spent in your other archetypes. No details on what exactly those archetypes do, but I imagine they'll be very late game archetypes that'll be pretty strong. Similar to NCAA 14, we have coach abilities. There are 50 to choose from in the game that are acquired by spending coach points. Each ability has up to 4 tiers, and every tier has a cost associated with it. Each archetype, with the exception of Scheme Guru, Program Builder, and CEO, has their ability broken down by position group. This increases the level of depth and specialization each coach has. So again, and we'll probably say this a million other times during this video, there's no such thing as a perfect coach. Some of these archetypes have very, very cool abilities, like this Scheme Guru one they mentioned. This one gives you certain bonuses based on your gameplay style. So if you're running an up-tempo, fast-paced offense, you get certain bonuses that will benefit that. So for example, tier 1 gives you slower fatigue for your offensive players while on hurry up. Tier 2 is called caught napping. I'm not really sure what this means, but it says that it increases the delay to defenders looking to the sideline at the snap. So maybe they get the wrong play call, or they just jump off the snap late. On their heels for tier 3 gives you increased composure for first down gain while running hurry up. And then tier 4, chance to see the defense's coverage shell in hurry up mode. Every offensive ability has a defensive counter, and every defensive ability has an offensive counter. There's a lot of going back and forth. Online dynasties should be great. Head coaches and both coordinators have these same archetypes and abilities available to them. And it's, like I said, very important to make sure that you're not solely focused on getting your head coach to be perfect, because it's impossible. It's about building a staff that has a head coach that's good at some stuff, and then having coordinators that either fix weaknesses or boost the already existing strengths that your head coach has. Because abilities do stack. So you have an increased effect if you have a head coach with one ability, and then you have an offensive coordinator that has the same ability. Unlike how it works in recent Maddens and also in NCAA 14, you do not get to choose where your coordinators spend their points. They exist on their own. And one thing that you will notice is that you might have a defensive coordinator that has an offensive ability, or vice versa. And the effectiveness of that ability will be lower for a defensive coordinator that has an offensive ability, because obviously that's not their area of expertise. When you start your dynasty as either a head coach or coordinator, you sign a contract with that school. They give you a set level of expectations based on that team's current prestige level, and you have to maintain a certain level of job security throughout your career or tenure at that school, or else you're probably going to get fired. Things like winning games, things like winning conference championships, making the college football playoffs, and obviously winning national titles help job security. Things like losing to rivals, things like going on losing streaks, those are things that will put you in the hot seat and ultimately will have you fired. Wins or losses against different opponents are also weighed differently based on the prestige of your team. If you're a small school and you beat Bama at Bama, that win is going to weigh way heavier than if you are, I don't know, Georgia beating Coastal Carolina. Obviously, it's the same thing if it's the other way around. If you are a powerhouse school like a Georgia and you lose to Coastal Carolina, you're going to probably be fired by the time the season's over. Coach prestige also works kind of similar to this, where the coach prestige, your gain or decline, will be based on your contract, your coach expectations, the school that you're at. So if you are, again, let's say a powerhouse school like Oregon, if you make the Pac-12 championship, because I'm bringing back the Pac-12 in my dynasty, that doesn't really weigh as much as if you are JMU, James Madison, and you win 6-7 games and make a bowl game. It's just nowhere near the same grind. The coaching carousel in college football 25 is expected to be chaotic, and I cannot wait to see what happens in that first offseason. All the coaching carousel drama kicks off during conference championship week, and during that week, all coach contracts are processed. So schools are going to look if they want to fire, extend, or let a coach contract expire. If you are fired or they extend you, you get a notification for it. The following week, that's when job offers go out for coaches and coordinators. So everyone's not going to get an offer the first week. It's going to be based on a few different things: your coach level, your coach's scheme in relation to that school scheme, your coach's archetype. So schools do have preferences for a lot of these things. They also are interested in your pipelines for recruiting. And then on top of that, obviously the big thing is coach prestige. As head coach, obviously you're in charge of managing your coordinators if they didn't leave for other jobs, that is. So if you have coordinators that you don't feel are complementing your skills, or you find something better on the market, you can obviously fire that coach in the offseason during that same portal and try to bring in new players or new coaches during that first week of bowl season. My favorite part of Dynasty Mode is obviously the team building process, the recruiting, the talent acquisition, the having to be prepared to lose a player in 4 years, and now having to be prepared to potentially lose a player in the transfer portal. This is going to be such a fresh experience, and it starts with recruiting, which is now in a staged process and is built around three different phases. You have discovery, pitch, and close. So just like in real life, every recruit will be in a different stage of their process, and where they are in that process will determine how you can interact with them and the level of engagement they require in the recruiting process. So recruiting starts with discovery. In this initial phase, you start by finding prospects that you want to target. You look at their skills, what they care about the most. One thing I loved that they mentioned in this article is how they humanize recruits so that every player feels unique, not just from a needs perspective, but also from a quality and caliber perspective, and how they're using historical data for high school talent to make sure that different regions of the country have certain types of talent. Like quarterbacks that come out of California every year are not going to be in the same class as a quarterback that comes out of like Montana or North Dakota. No offense if you're, you know, a quarterback from one of those states. Keep you know, grinding, keep trying to achieve your dreams. But I'm just saying, it's not the same type of talent normally based on historical data. And that's what we're talking about here. Throughout the course of the year, that player is going to trim their schools down. And if you make it to their top five, that's when you get to pitch your school to that recruit and how well your school aligns with their motivations and their needs. That's going to determine how successful you are. After that, time to pull out the big guns. It's time to make your move and try to close that recruit by bringing them in for an official visit. And hopefully, following that visit, you get a verbal commitment. But here's the big change this year. Verbal commitments, just like they are in real life, are not binding. Let's be real. How many five-star recruits in real life over the past couple of years have you seen verbally commit to a program, and then throughout the course of the year, either during the season or on National Signing Day, switch up and they're wearing another school's hat? That can happen in EA Sports College Football 25. That is the level of chaos that recruiting is going to have. Nothing is set in stone until National Signing Day. And remember what we talked about in the last video. Just because you didn't land that recruit, if you were high enough on their board during the recruiting process and they hit the transfer portal, they're going to remember your school. But a lot of that has to do with how your school is weighed per recruit. This is going to boil down to a school grade per recruit, and it works pretty much the same as it did with NCAA 14, where you have a D minus to A plus grade across 14 categories: playing time, playing style, championship contender, campus lifestyle, pro potential, brand exposure is the new one, which is the NIL variant of this game. You have conference prestige, academic prestige, coach stability, athletic facilities, proximity to home, pretty much everything we had before. Same system, works pretty much exactly the same way. The big thing, obviously, is brand exposure. A lot of people are upset that they didn't just come out and call this NIL. NIL is a changing landscape, and I think that EA Sports College Football is handling this pretty much the right way. Players aren't going to have, you know, car dealership deals, and like they said in the article, they're not going to have a mustard named after them, but it's a reflection of your school's brand and potential NIL opportunities. So recruits and transfers will assess their NIL or brand exposure earning potential, and that considers where they end up going. Each recruiting class for College Football 25 will have over 3,500 recruits that are generated, and just like in the real world, every class is going to be different. Some years you'll have great quarterback talent, some years less. Some years you'll have great defensive line talent. Some years you won't have really any standout defensive linemen. And this is going to end up putting a lot of emphasis on making sure that you are prioritizing players that are achievable for your program. Obviously, you want to get the best talent possible, but those five-star players, if you aren't a top-end school, you're not going to give them what they want. You're not going to get them to the pro level. You're not going to get them championships. You're not going to have really high brand exposure. And those are things that could be ideal pitches or key factors to recruiting that recruit. Because most of the time, those things are going to be considered deal breakers. And deal breakers is really similar to what we had in NCAA 14, where during the pitch stage, you'll learn what are like no-goes for these recruits. So say, for example, this player is based out of West Virginia and your school's in California. If their deal breaker is they want to stay close to home to play football, you're going to have a very hard time getting that recruit. It's going to be an uphill battle that's probably not going to be worth your time. Deal breakers also stay with recruits throughout their time on your team. So say, for example, you are bringing in a player that wants to win a championship. If your team starts to decline and it's looking very clear that you are missing your championship window for that player, that deal breaker will kick in. That player will hit the transfer portal and leave. They mentioned this earlier in the article, but there was a lot of energy put into understanding where the top recruits come from. And that has really influenced how the pipeline system works in College Football 25, because it's no longer just one state as an entire pipeline. For example, Florida now has three pipelines within that state. There's North Florida, Central Florida, and South Florida. Metro Atlanta has its own pipeline. New York and New Jersey are now combined into a single pipeline. There are 50 in total. These are no longer based on the state, and I think the game's better for that. There's no longer just earning a pipeline status by recruiting three players and holding three players. You now have five different levels to each pipeline region. And each school starting out Dynasty mode will have a pipeline level associated with their certain regions. So for Florida, they're normally very dominant with recruiting in Central Florida. I imagine they would be level five. LSU has very strong recruiting in East Texas and along the Gulf Coast. They'll probably have top tier recruiting in those areas. So when you look at this new recruiting system, you look at the way pipelines work now, you look at the deal breakers, ideal pitches, the way that school grades work, it's going to be kind of hard for small schools to get top players. It's not going to be impossible, but it'll definitely be a grind. Getting off to a strong start in recruiting starts in the discovery phase, and returning from NCAA 14 is the prospect identification filter, which allows you to sort and filter based on position, player type, archetype, state, minimum star rating, height, weight, handedness for quarterbacks, and obviously interest in your school. Paying attention to your team's strengths and weaknesses, and also your scheme is very important because depending on your scheme, you might need a certain number of offensive or defensive players. So for example, the veer and shoot offensive style, you need 10 wide receivers, minimum. For the pro style, you only need 6. Recruiting hours are now replacing the point system we had from NCAA 14, and the amount of points that you have to spend are based on your prestige and what part of the season you're in. Example, during the preseason, 5-star programs have 1,000 recruiting hours. A 1-star only has 350. Obviously, the recruiting landscape and the recruiting power of a smaller school is much different from a big powerhouse program. So this does make sense. It makes it much more of a grind, again, for small schools, but that's how it should be. In addition to being capped on hours, there's also a limit on how many hours you can pour into a recruit per week. The default max is 50, but there are abilities that can upgrade that to a maximum of 70. Once you get your recruiting board together and it's time to start scouting, there are multiple phases of this. There's unscouted, partially scouted, mostly scouted, and then fully scouted. This is obviously based on the amount of hours you put into a person. So when you begin that scouting process and they're unscouted, you know nothing but their star rating, their height, their weight, their hometown, their position, and their archetype. When you get to partially scouted, you'll see a horizontal bar appear. The left side is at 0 and the right side is at 99. This is obviously the range between 0 and 99 for their attribute rating. Within that is a gold bar that covers 25% of that bar space. The player's true rating is somewhere within that range. When a player is mostly scouted, that gold bar range drops from 25 to 10%, which narrows down that rating. And then at fully scouted, you know everything about that player, all their ratings, their overall. You've gone through the entire process. During scouting, you will learn the player's physical and mental abilities, but before National Signing Day, unless you have a specific ability, you won't learn their dev trait. Finding a 3-star gem in NCAA 14 that ended up being like a +9 that put him on par with a 5-star was really fun. And while that system is returning, it doesn't seem like it's going to be as dramatic, which is fine. So what they're saying is a 4-star bust is more like a quality 3-star, and then a 4-star gem is like a 5-star. So yes, there's going to be blue chip prospects, but they're not going to be as prevalent as they were before. There's going to be a lot more uncertainty with recruiting, which is totally fine, by the way. I like having more dice rolls when it comes to scouting and recruiting. It makes it a little less stale. After you start narrowing down prospects, you're back into the pitch phase again. And this is when you can start doing things like offering scholarships. You can DM the player. You can be really creepy and contact their family or friends. You can send recruiters to their house. You can search through their social media. And this is when you can start unlocking their motivators and seeing where you fit in. It'll either give you a check mark or a red X for their motivators. So if you are too far from them and they have a really high grade for proximity to home, again, you're not going to be a good fit. If you are a very good academic school and academics are his most important thing, that's good for you. And that allows you to then in stage 2 of pitch to either hard sell or soft sell based on what you've unlocked. So if you know that you are a very good academic school and his big thing is academics, hard sell in academics. If you're not really sure what his motivations are, you're probably better off saving your time because you also have to spend recruiting points or recruiting hours on each one of these actions. So if you're hard selling, it's 40 recruiting hours, which takes away from the 50 that you have max per week or 70 if you have the upgrade. A lot of weighing and balancing your options when it comes to going after players. Final stage of recruiting is closing, and this is when you bring the prospect in for a visit and attempt to just lock them down with a verbal commitment and hope that when you get to National Signing Day, everything goes as planned. When you schedule a visit, it's 40 recruiting hours. It does not go against the max hours you can allocate per recruit per week. So essentially you're spending like 90 recruiting points on a recruit once you get to the closing stage, which if you're a small 1-star school could be pretty expensive. Closing stage is broken down into 2 different parts. There's scheduling and activity. It's really about timing, just like it was in NCAA 14. Bringing in recruits during a big game like a rivalry week could be very big for points if you win and impress that recruit, but if you lose, it could have a really, really bad effect on your recruiting status. You'd also be kind of wasting a visit if you had a big time recruit coming in as a powerhouse school against a cupcake team. For example, you bring in a 4-star safety when you're playing FCS Southeast, that win doesn't really mean much, but if you lose that game, that recruit's probably gonna block you and tell you to never call his friends or family again. You can also schedule activities for recruits when they come in, so having them attend a position meeting or have dinner with the team or attend a practice or a variety of things would help that visit. Other things that help visits, complimentary visits. If a quarterback visits with a receiver or left tackle, that's a bonus, but you also have competitive visits, so if two quarterbacks visit at the same time, it's probably not the best idea. Don't do that in the same week. We all know the transfer portal is very volatile, and it's very important to make sure that you're taking care of your top players, because if you have a deal breaker violated and they're a high overall player, they're more likely to leave. You can persuade them to stay, but there's no guarantee that that's going to work. It's a slightly different situation if you have a school grade that drops to a certain point, because that does actively update throughout the season. And once it gets to the end of the year, they will evaluate whether or not they want to stay on your team. If they do decide to stay, you only have a certain number of persuasion attempts that you can use to keep them around. There are abilities that help you retain players that not only want to leave, but are low on persuasion attempts. The offseason in College Football 25 is 4 weeks total, and that's when a lot of the chaos is going to happen. You have National Signing Day. You have four really big weeks of recruiting and trying to hit the transfer portal to find players to bring in. That transfer portal process in the offseason works pretty similarly to the high school portion during and throughout the season. Each transfer player has a national, state, and position ranking. They have an overall. Their deal breaker is the same one that forced them to transfer. They will get new motivations and ideal pitches. And you've got to make decisions very fast. They're saying this is a fast environment. You've got to make quick decisions. You need to analyze what your needs are very quickly and try to figure out the best players for you. College Football 25 has not only National Signing Day, but also Early Signing Day. Early Signing Day takes place after the start of bowl season, and National Signing Day takes place 7 weeks after the national championship. On Signing Day, any players who have verbally committed to a school prior to Signing Day will sign, meaning they can no longer decommit. So like we've seen in the past, those are players that sign mid-season, and then you have players that are going to be in those runoffs at the end of the year. And here's a cool thing, unlike in NCAA 14, those players that go unsigned after National Signing Day, they don't just disappear. Those players, they're going to walk on. So as long as you are the team with the highest influence on Signing Day and you offer them a scholarship, if they didn't make a decision based on what they have in the article, that player will walk on and not just disappear forever. I hated when that happened. It's like, I tried so hard to get you, you couldn't make up your mind. Did you just give up on football? After National Signing Week, you have the position change window. So if you had athletes that you recruited, you can move them to different positions. If you have a receiver you wanted to move to running back, you can do that. They get new physical abilities, but their mental abilities do not change, unless that mental ability isn't available at that position. Player progression is getting some really nice tweaks in EA Sports College Football 25, similar to NCAA 14. Attributes will upgrade every offseason, but there is a really interesting tweak here. So opposed to how it used to work in NCAA 14, where it kind of just seemed like everyone got the same flat number attribute increase, your progression during the offseason is based on your school year, the coach abilities, and their development trait. Depth traits in College Football 25 are normal, impact, star, and elite, compared to Madden, obviously, with normal, star, superstar, X Factor. Younger impact players like a rising sophomore will normally see a higher progression during the offseason than a rising senior, which is kind of cool. They've added a skill group system, which feels very Madden-ish, if that's even a word. So as opposed to upgrading their ratings individually, they're now going to be upgrading their ratings through a skill group. So it's a collection of related attributes. So it works very similar, if not the exact same way that the upgrades work in Madden. However, you can only upgrade each skill group 10 times. So each player essentially has a cap on how good they can get. You can't turn a 2-star player into a 99 overall. It's just not going to work. Every player has a ceiling. Every player has a potential that they can reach and they can't get past. Every player can have a max of 5 physical and 3 mental abilities. We talked about that in the last video. They all have separate tiers: bronze, silver, gold, platinum. Physical abilities are determined based on the player's archetype, while mental are position specific. Again, physical abilities can be upgraded by meeting a certain attribute threshold, while mental abilities cannot be upgraded at all. Impact players are returning for College Football 25, and as you can see on the field, there are quite a lot of them. NCAA 14 had a cap. That is not the case for College Football 25. You can have a full starting 22 with impact players. The wear and tear system is going to have you making some very crucial decisions in Dynasty, because is that -8 break tackle, -5 change of direction, -5 speed worth having your star player out there on the field if he's got a pretty good chance of re-injuring or even aggravating an injury? Probably not. The new 12-team College Football Playoff format is going to be a fun one to test in Dynasty before we even get to see that in real life. In the article, they say they had to create a unique logic for our College Football Playoff poll to model how we anticipate the rankings to look in the new format. Generating a believable opinion-based poll is no easy feat, especially one where we are projecting what may happen versus being able to use the real-world results as reference points. And that is a good point. We don't know exactly how the 12-team format is going to work when it comes to the voting and the polls. That is completely up in the air. Maybe they'll get it right this first year. Maybe it'll be a little bit off from where it is in real life, but something's better than nothing. Messing around with custom conferences is going to be very, very fun. You can have as little as 4 per conference, up to 20. Like I said before, I will be bringing back the Pac-12, moving all those teams back over. And the great thing is that I don't have to worry about uniform patches being incorrect or on-field graphics being wrong, because all of that stuff updates for every team regardless. There's also a pretty good amount of conference rules, which is good. I believe this is around the same number of options we had for NCAA 14. Maybe the number of conference games changed. But one thing they have noted and they're putting a lot of attention into is making sure that key matchups, especially your big rivalry games, are happening when they're supposed to happen every single year of your dynasty. The kickoff classic games are going to be included. Week 0 is being included. They included as many of the high profile home away series as they could. So 2027 and 2028 Florida, Georgia. They have 2029, 2030 Alabama, Notre Dame. The schedule generator is supposed to be really good. It's a lot of very good attention to detail. You have your crowd themes for your rivalry and game of the week matchups, also your first home game of the season. So whiteout, blackout, checkerboard, striping, etc. I don't know how that's going to work for team builder schools, because normally you would just adopt the rival of the team that you ended up swapping out in team builder. I wasn't really a huge fan of that. Hopefully that's something that can be changed. Speaking of team builder, you can now import up to 16 team builder schools into a private online dynasty. It is 32 players per online dynasty. So I'm not sure if that means that you can have 16 team builder and then 16 normal, or if you're just hard locked at 16 if you do team builder imports. But whatever we get, that's great. Hopefully they can give us a full 32 team builder schools next year. That would be amazing. The rules for redshirt players has also been updated for College Football 25. So if a freshman doesn't play more than 4 games, they maintain their redshirt status, meaning they have an extra year of eligibility. And obviously, if they play that 5th game, that redshirt gets burned. This is really cool because it gives you a chance to see those players on the field, at least in a small capacity, rather than having to wait an entire year to see them. Spending all year recruiting a freshman and then not wanting to play that player because I don't want to waste his time because we're not quite ready for him, but he'll be absolutely ready for next year. It was so painful in NCAA 14, but now I get a little sample size of that five or four star player. We've seen quite a few trophies on display in these initial couple of trailers for College Football 25. Your big rivalry ones are there. We knew the Heisman would be in the game, but it looks like they've also acquired licensing for the Lou Groza, the Lombardi, and the Unitas Golden Arm Award, along with a few others they haven't named. And then they also have an award for Head Coach of the Year and Best Coordinator in the country, the Broyles Award, which is kind of cool. What is college football without All-Americans? We have not only preseason, but also postseason All-Americans for the national first, second, and freshman teams and the conference first, second, and freshman teams. Player, team, and coach stats work the same way they did in NCAA 14, but for the first time, College Football 25 is tracking records at a conference level. And while they only mention Ohio State and Florida State, pride stickers are in the game this year. And they worked with each school individually to figure out how the pride stickers are filled in on each helmet over the course of a year. That is really, really good attention to detail. I hope that Team Builder has pride stickers, but that possibly is a reach. But that, guys, is the end of this 1,700-word, 85-page deep dive into Dynasty. Whoever wrote this up, you are a champ. But thank you guys for tuning in. Hope you guys enjoyed. What's next for College Football 25? What's our next deep dive? Probably Road to the College Football Playoff. It's probably going to be Road to Glory. Hopefully that's not 85 pages. But hey, the more detail, the better. I will see you all next time. Have a great day.